What you get is what you got. Cause when they own the information, oh, they can bend it all they want. That's why we're waiting, waiting, waiting on the world to change. We keep on waiting, waiting, waiting on the world to change.
Welcome, everyone. I think most of us are here. So welcome again to the 13th annual CUNY Accessibility Conference, and welcome to the last session for today. Before we begin, it is my pleasure to introduce the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities, also known as CCSD, Universal Design, Learning and Leadership, also known as UDL Squared, and the Mayor's Office for People with Disabilities Representatives, also known as MOPD. And before we begin, I'd like to hand off the mic to Charmaine Townsell.
Thank you so much, Tanya. I am a big John Legend fan. I appreciate that from our students. The presenters we've had throughout the week and that we'll have today aren't waiting for the world to change. They are changing the world. So just a few housekeeping rules. First, I want to thank Howard Hines, our CUNY Director of Deaf and Hard of Hearing Services, for his assistance coordinating our ASL interpreters who have done an amazing job this week and for being here with us today. Please note, they will be spotlighted for all those who need it. Next, captions will also be available throughout the presentation. You can access them through the CC closed caption button at the bottom of your Zoom screen. Finally, if you're having technical difficulties, as we all have experienced during the time in this virtual environment, please put them in the chat and someone will try to assist you. It is our honor to welcome everyone to the final session of the 13th annual CUNY Accessibility Conference. What an amazing week we have had with such dynamic speakers and participants. Special thanks to my friends and colleagues, all the hardworking, dedicated staff on the CUNY Accessibility Conference Committee, chaired by our friend and colleague Tanya, our partners in IT at Queensborough Community College, under the leadership of Queensborough Community College President Dr. Christine Mangino. My name is Charmaine Townsell, and I am a light-skinned African-American woman whose pronouns are she, her, hers, wearing glasses, and I have braids. I want to turn the mic over to my friend and colleague from the Boogie Down Bronx, or as our students like to say, the South South Bronx, the South Bronx, Mr. Raymond Perez. Take it away, Ray.
Thank you, Char. My name is Raymond Perez, and I serve as the Director of Disability Service, Veteran Affairs, and the Testing Center at Host Hills Community College. I also am proud to serve as one of the co-advisors, along with my BFF and friend, Ms. Charmaine Townsell, as one of the CCSE advisors. I identify as a light-skinned male Latino who has short brown hair and whose pronouns are he, him, and his. I'm wearing a blue blazer, a checkered blue and white dress shirt, and a solid navy blue tie. Charmaine?
Thank you, Ray. Research has shown that participation in student clubs and organizations is highly correlated with persistence and student success, therefore directly affecting graduation and retention rates amongst historically underrepresented student communities in higher education. Among students with disabilities at CUNY, the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities, CCSD, has been the primary force for peer-to-peer engagement among students with disabilities. Indeed, CCSD is a thriving coalition of campus-based student organizations. CCSD and its campus chapters have improved cross-CUNY representation in shared governance and policy development. In addition, they became valued partners in enhancing CUNY's ability to engage students with disabilities in a remote learning setting and work experience, especially during distance learning, where the stakes have never been higher for disabled student engagement. This past summer, CUNY partnered with the Summer Youth Employment, recruiting 5,000 students for employment opportunities. CCSD took full advantage of this opportunity and answered the call and participated in the CUNY Recovery Corps, or as they renamed it, the CUNY Accessibility Corps. We are proud to share that all the students or employees that participated in the Accessibility Corps, we were able to obtain 100% retention, where we facilitated job readiness trainings, leadership development, and assistive technology training. Most excitingly, several of those interns successfully transitioned to employment and some of our disabled services offices throughout CUNY. Ray?
CCSD, understanding the impact of experiential learning and the need for further development and training to empower students in becoming more effective leaders capable of developing and sustaining successful student campus organization through advocacy, turned to CUNY leadership to fund a program that will continue to provide such opportunities. Who better to create and lead such a project but CCSD Executive Board, who had successfully designed and built partnerships among students and New York State legislators to advocate for 80,000 disabled college students in New York State. Today, the project is known as UDL Squared, Universal Design, Learning, and Leadership Project. Through CCSD and UDL Squared's tireless efforts, they were able to secure an additional $2 million in funding to enhance supportive services for college students with disabilities last year, and continue to advocate for additional funds. It is important to note that Ms. Lennyn Jacob, CCSD Chair and UDL Square staff member, has been recognized as one of the top 100 most influential people in education in New York State, in the company of chancellors, college presidents, and New York State legislators. Lennyn and CCSD continue to demonstrate the power of leadership, advocacy, and determination to make sure students with disabilities are not forgotten. Thank you, CCSD, for your continued support and advocacy. It is our pleasure to introduce you to the CCSD Executive Board. Charmaine, take it away.
Thank you, Ray. First, we'll start off with Lennyn Jacob. Lennyn, as Ray had shared, was in the top 100 of city and state. And Lennyn, or as the students like to call you, MCJ, you may have been 99 in city and state, but you will always be number one in our hearts. Then we have Arlene. She is the vice chair of finance, who often appears reserved and shy, but she has passion and is a staunch advocate and who is dedicated, consistently reliable, and kind. Arlene proudly goes to LaGuardia Community College. And of course, we have Xavier Santiago. Xavier is the vice chair of recruitment, or as we like to call him, podcast guy. He is consistently focused on engaging students. He has funny, quick wit and keeps everyone laughing. And Xavier proudly goes to Lehman College. And last, but certainly not least, we have Leonard Blades, the executive vice chair, or who we like to call Bladesy. Leonard is a dedicated student leader and a graduate student. Leonard is also an example of a success story, where Leonard was able to successfully transition from being a tax consumer to a tax contributor and is a full-time staff member at this great university. We are truly proud of them all. But enough from hearing from us. It is now my pleasure. Thank you for keeping up with me, Alyssa. It is now my pleasure to turn the mic over to Lennyn Jacob. Take it away, Lennyn.
Thank you, Charmaine. It is an honor to be here today and to have the opportunity to do what we do through CCSD. As Charmaine said, my name is Lennyn Jacob. I am a disabled Latina woman with long hair, brushed to the side, and Black glasses. My pronouns are she, her, ella, and I am a student at Bronx Community College. In addition to being a parent and an employee, I am also the chairperson of the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities, CCSD, the representative organization for the more than 11,000 students with disabilities throughout CUNY. Next slide, please. Now, CCSD has a long-standing history of advocacy when it comes to both students and the disability community. But to advocate, we must first identify a need. As the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities, we identified retention and graduation difficulties as a need that our historically marginalized students were facing. It cannot be expressed enough that consequences linked to students dropping out prior to graduation can adversely affect their future. Consequences can range from loss of employment, loss of advancement opportunities, and lower paying jobs, just to name a few. However, to understand the cost of retention and graduation difficulties, one must first understand the reason why students choose to leave school. This is where CCSD chose to take a deeper dive into our community of CUNY students and inquire about the obstacles students at CUNY were facing. We wanted to know what obstacles were directly impacting our students and leading them down an unwanted and unintended path. It was when we chose to speak to our community about what was ailing them that these obstacles became clear. First, students cannot transfer their credits from one campus to another. Now imagine, if you will, you find yourself having to attend a different college for any number of reasons. Perhaps your current campus does not offer the major you desire, or perhaps you moved and needed better access to a closer campus. Whatever the reason, not being able to transfer your credits between CUNY campuses left many students having to start from scratch and taking on the additional financial burden of paying for the same type of classes again. Over time, this would also deplete their financial aid awards, and they would find themselves having to pay out-of-pocket costs if they wanted to continue their educational journey, all because CUNY campuses were not accepting general education credits from other schools within the CUNY system. The second obstacle was that students and faculty did not know the benefits of being registered with their campus disability services office. The Americans with Disabilities Act, ADA, passed into law in 1990. And yet there were CUNY students and faculty who not only did not know about their campus disability services offices, but also did not understand students with certain difficulties could have access to needed accommodations that could ultimately level the playing field academically. This was about lack of knowledge. On one hand, students not already registered with the Disability Services Office did not know they could seek services. And on the other hand, some faculty did not understand the need for encouraging students to seek services. The third obstacle was that students with non-math majors were being held back from graduating due to one math course. Now picture this, you've completed 2 to 4 full years of college courses. You're one class away from graduation. Your only difficulty is one required math class you can't seem to pass. You've attempted it various times and to no avail. What do you do now? That one class is the only thing keeping you from reaching the completion of your degree. That was the case for many non-math majors. And the question became, why would a class that has nothing to do with an individual's major be the only thing depriving them of the degree they've worked so hard towards? This was another big problem. We needed a solution, but what could we do? So we thought it through, and like all great advocacy, we took it back to basics with our grassroots efforts. Next slide, please. Now, grassroots is defined as the most basic level of organization. It is important to remember that as these obstacles were identified, one thing that was clear was that these had been issues that had been plaguing students in CUNY for decades. Previous unsuccessful attempts had been made to bring awareness to these concerns, but it wasn't until coalition building happened surrounding these three obstacles that the issue of retention and graduation was truly addressed. You may be wondering, how did we make this happen? Well, we focused on the following three strategies. First, identifying key players. Second, providing testimony whenever possible. And third, we connected with and organized the CUNY student body. It was imperative that in identifying key players, we opted to reach out to, speak with, and connect with these individuals to begin the necessary dialogue. There were many key players that proved to be instrumental in addressing these obstacles. We worked with CUNY senior leadership, which included former CUNY provost Alexandra Loeb. CCSD met with former CUNY interim chancellor Vita Rabinowitz, as well as former assistant vice chancellor Dr. Chris Rosa. We partnered with and communicated with the Faculty Senate, as well as the CUNY Professional Staff Congress. We communicated and collaborated with math departments across CUNY campuses and attended CUNY Board of Trustees meetings. It was this relentless effort to network that opened up the opportunity for us to provide testimony whenever possible on these obstacles. We gave testimony at all CUNY public hearings. We shared the various obstacles surrounding retention and graduation difficulties faced by CUNY students and put a face to these matters. It was the face of the average CUNY student. At CUNY Board of Trustees meetings, we argued that basic algebra is basic algebra at a community college or a senior college. Finally, we connected with and organized the CUNY student body. We did so by meeting with and advocating alongside faculty, University Student Senate, the SUNY Student Assembly, various student government organizations, associations, NYPERG, and CUNY student organizations. In addition to this coalition building, we connected to email and social media to make the initiatives a success. We launched educational campaigns where we actively participated in videos that were shared CUNY-wide to educate people on how these obstacles were affecting CUNY students. Students played an important role within select task force committees and shared their voice in the representation of CUNY students university-wide. Next slide, please. Thank you. Now it is my great privilege to announce that the results of the organized and calculated grassroots efforts were nothing short of staggering. Three major solutions came about as a response to the obstacles CUNY students were advocating for. First, in 2013, CUNY implemented the Pathways Initiative across its undergraduate colleges. Pathways established a new system of general education requirements and new transfer guidelines across the university. By doing so, it has reinforced CUNY's educational excellence and commitment to low-income and traditionally marginalized New Yorkers while easing student transfer between CUNY's 25 college campuses. With the successful passing of CUNY Pathways by the CUNY Board of Trustees, we now have a logical and strategic way for students to successfully transfer from one CUNY campus to another without the burden of sacrificing more money and time to repeat unnecessary courses. Next, we'll share a video that demonstrates CCSD students advocating for pathways. Next slide, please.
When students transfer from community colleges to senior colleges, they deserve to have all their credits valued, because when they don't, they waste their time, their money, and it delays their future.
Thanks to the CUNY Pathways Project, the City University of New York
is guiding its individual colleges to work together as a family
in helping us reach our career goals faster.
CUNY Pathways is a bold initiative
to unify our
general education requirements when transferring between CUNY colleges.
Prior to the Pathways Project, we had no voice in the credit review process.
When our credits weren't properly received, we had no say in it.
When our credits are accepted,
they are often placed into an elective category.
Also, financial aid does not cover repeating the same class at a different campus.
We actually receive less assistance and instead have to pay more out of pocket for our degree.
Pathways is particularly important to students with disabilities because it avoids them having to retake and pay for classes that Access VR might not pay for.
With Pathways, students with disabilities can transfer their credits easily, and they don't have to worry about, you know, not being able to pay for a class.
With Pathways, our courses will count
for what they were intended to.
Thanks to Pathways, a math course at a community college is worth the same as a math course at a senior college.
Students across CUNY are leading the efforts to reform
the broken transfer process.
The Pathway Project started with me.
Me.
Me. And it will continue with you.
Thanks to Pathways,
I'm on the right path.
I'm on the right path.
I'm on the right path.
Now, unlike Pathways, which was a university-wide win for CUNY students, this next one has found local success at various campuses in its pursuit of uniformity throughout the university is still ongoing. While many are still advocating for a university-wide policy that encourages CUNY campus faculty to incorporate an ADA accommodation statement on their syllabus, there is still a need regarding accessing disability services and needed accommodations for students with disabilities. But we are thankful for the progress that has been made thus far. We look forward to one day seeing this as a university-wide policy and not simply a recommendation. Finally, another university-wide win for CUNY students was the math substitution policy. When the university chose to establish this policy, it helped students with various levels of difficulties in math achieve graduation. Now students have a standard policy for substitution that allows them to take the course one or more times with accommodations before qualifying for a math waiver. This option would be a determining factor in an individual's ability to graduate from a non-math major and be able to take on future careers. With retention and graduation addressed, I am proud to say that CCSD and its coalition of organizations and individuals made this happen. CUNY students did that. Thanks to our wonderful advisors, Charmaine Townsell and Raymond Perez, we have the knowledge to push these efforts forward. Now, I'd like to pass it over to the next presenter, CCSD Vice Chair of Finance, Arlene Basant. Arlene, take it away.
Thank you, Lennyn. Hello, everyone. My name is Arlene Basant, and I currently serve as the Vice Chair of Finance for the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities, CCSD. I'm a brown-skinned Indo-Caribbean female with my hair pulled back with a black shirt on. My pronouns are she, her, hers. The second CCSD victory that we will be highlighting today is the Distance Learning Toolkit, which was designed to help anyone struggling to adjust to the online learning environment. Therefore, we decided it would be fitting to make something that directly supports all students, staff, and faculty, and including those with disabilities. At the beginning of March 2020, CUNY was trusted into virtual learning. Our disabled and non-disabled peers share frustration with all that was associated with transitioning from in-person classes to a distance learning platform. And together, we identify a need for education around the subject. Many students we spoke to also seem to be unaware of the resources available to them through their campus. Next slide, please. We decided to take action. In a situation where so many of us may have felt powerless, we instead chose to devise a plan. The plan was to create a distance learning toolkit, which would house information relative to the subject to be used by students who are newly remote. Based on our conversation with students and research, we came up with a few categories. Remote workstation, work-life balance, stress management, personal health, organization, and practical study techniques. We also felt it was important to highlight the services available on student home campuses that address issues like food insecurity, COVID testing, equipment loans, disability services, and counseling. Together, we did that. Another important element of our plan was to decide how we would market the tool and get it to students. Because what good is information if nobody has access to it or reads it? Next slide, please. Thank you. We worked tirelessly to ensure the creation of the toolkit with the help of our CUNY CATS team. Once the toolkit was fully organized, written, and published, we began the fun part, promotion. We spoke to many university organizations and asked for their partnership with publicizing this information and helping us find a place on their campus where they could present it to a student audience, like clubs, SGA meeting, new student orientations, and so on. Some of those amazing partners included the CUNY Central Office of Student Inclusion Initiative, our advisor, Charmaine Townsell, the Universal Design Learning and Leadership Project with our advisor, Raymond Perez, the CUNY Council on Student Disability Issues, made up of our hardworking disability services professionals, Vice Chancellor Dr. Denise Maybank, the CUNY Central Office for Communication and Marketing, and so many others. Next slide, please. Following its completion, the Distance Learning Toolkit was published at the end of fall 2020 and distributed to all CUNY students, staff, and faculty via listserv, the CUNY Brief, the Office of Academic Affairs This Week newsletter. We didn't stop there. The toolkit was also sent out to all student life directors, directors of disability services, women centers, immigrant student liaison, the CUNY LGBTQI plus council, directors of veterans, and so many others throughout CUNY. Our toolkit proved successful since it was utilized as a resource by students, faculty, and staff university-wide. Students had a reliable resource in one place to access information on food banks, the importance of self-care and time management, accessible technology, mental health and wellness hotlines, highlighting best practices for navigating our new distance learning environment at CUNY. We also organized and facilitated events sharing step-by-step instruction on how to navigate technology. The announcement of the distance learning toolkit came on the opening day of last year's accessibility conference, with our presentation being first welcome remarks from Dr. Denise Maybank and Chris Rosa. The executive board of CCSD at that time introduced the concept for the toolkit, shared their inspiration and broke down each section and subsection and encouraged attendees to help circulate it to students among the university. We put together a playful slide deck featuring images, music, jokes, and personal anecdotes to keep folks engaged. Since its publication, students have shared their positive feedback and appreciation during our live presentation and on feedback surveys for the toolkit. We also receive a positive response from staff and faculty across CUNY schools, some of whom even tailored the toolkit to their websites. We are still continuously improving and updating the toolkit based on feedback. We thank all those who connected and share ideas on how to make the toolkit better in their own personal time. We are thankful for your volunteerism and positive support and feedback. The most recent change being the translation of the toolkit into Spanish at the request of CUNY students in the Bronx, as they would say. Now I'd like to hand it off to my wonderful friend and colleague, our CCSD Vice Chair of Recruitment, Xavier Santiago. Take it away, Xavier.
Thank you, Arlene, for that amazing introduction. I would like to say my name is Xavier Santiago. My pronouns are he, him, and his. I am a Latino man with short hair and a goatee with headphones. And today, I am also the Vice Chair of Recruitment, and I will be discussing the third W of CUNY, lack of representation and inclusion in university-wide athletics programs. CUNY was established in 1961. Later in 1987, the CUNY Athletics Conference, part of the Division III National Collegiate Athletics Association and National Junior College Athletics Association, was initiated. Since their inception, they have pledged a commitment to focus on the student as much as the athlete and student athlete. This was wonderful for CUNY, but its focus left out a group of the CUNY population that very much needed and wanted to be included. Students with disabilities did not have inclusive and accessible sports to participate in at CUNY. And in essence, disabled athletes faced a lack of representation and inclusion in our university-wide athletics program. This was an issue that required a solution. And so CCSD, like with other issues beforehand, did what it does best. We developed our grassroots strategy. Next slide. It was important to us, CCSD, as we represent the more than 11,000 students with disabilities at CUNY, that we displayed the great demand for inclusion in CUNY sports to offer our students an opportunity to experience the benefits of athletics as part of the college experience. We wanted to ensure that our CUNY students with disabilities also had the opportunity, like every other athlete, to experience benefits such as learning to be comfortable with stepping out of their comfort zone, being challenged and having guidance by way of mentorship through coaching and advisement. For many students at CUNY, the greatest urban university in the world, what made it so attractive was the balance between academics and co-curricular opportunities. And we wanted to expand that option to our students with disabilities, so we got to work. We began by bringing exposure to this issue. We talked to, partnered, and essentially worked with organizations both in and out of CUNY that understood the need for developing a way to include students with disabilities in this very important aspect of college life. In doing so, CCSD worked in conjunction with the Central Office of Student Affairs and other organizations to advance true inclusion at CUNY by promoting the development of inclusive athletics. Finally, we focus on coalition building. CCSD has also worked alongside the U.S. Olympic Committee and U.S. Paralympics, NYC Parks and Recreation, Wheelchair Sports Federation, USS, and the CUNY Veteran Affairs Office. It was imperative that we built a coalition that would ensure our disabled athletes access to these opportunities. We knew that for years prior to inclusive athletics coming to CUNY, CUNY found itself with several exceptional student athletes that excelled in areas such as swimming, wheelchair tennis, and wheelchair basketball. Some even got the opportunity to participate at the Paralympic Games in London, and we wanted to ensure that they could do those things right here at CUNY. Next slide. The payout was nothing short of remarkable. The result of this 2017 initiative was a promise to bring track and field, swimming, tennis, and basketball as inclusive, accessible sports to the university's collegiate model. CUNY now hosts the first wheelchair basketball team on the Eastern Seaboard. They made their CUNY Athletics Conference debut in 2018 when they held their first clinic at Hostos Community College. Other clinics followed at Queens College, the College of Staten Island, and LaGuardia Community College, ensuring that our veteran students also had the opportunity to participate. This initiative had added real value to our CUNY campuses as it strives to have inclusion of Paralympic eligible athletes onto existing teams, competitions, and championships with reasonable sports-specific accommodations. To this date, CUNY Inclusive and Adaptive Sports has over 35 students across 14 CUNY campuses. Recently, the program has landed their first ever partnership deal with New Motion, the nation's largest and leading provider of products and services that provide mobility, health, and personal independence for people with disabilities, as well as joined the ranks of the National Wheelchair Basketball Association. Thanks to their recent membership with NWBA, CUNY is now being represented thanks to accessible sports on a national stage. We are very proud of our wheelchair basketball team and CUNY for making inclusion in sports a reality for students with disabilities. It is now my honor. I get the privilege to introduce our Executive Vice Chair, Leonard Blades. Take it away, Leonard.
Xavier, thank you so much. I appreciate that. Greetings, everyone. My name is Leonard Blades. My pronouns are he, him, his. I am a Black man with short hair wearing a long sleeve blue shirt. I am also a current student at the CUNY School of Professional Studies, and I proudly serve as the Executive Vice Chair for the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities, CCSD. The last victory that we will be highlighting today is regarding voter registration and education and its impact on higher education disability funding. A major issue we were able to identify was the fact that historically marginalized communities experienced a lack of engagement when it comes to voting, ultimately leading to a direct lack of funding for disability services and higher education. Coming from these communities ourselves, we understood the difficulties associated with this issue, but wanted to reach out to our CCSD and CUNY communities to hear what difficulties they and their families faced when it came to voting. we understood that the ability to vote is one of the most important ways in which a person can have their voice heard. The people that CCSD represents, people with disabilities at CUNY, are a marginalized community. This community's lack of engagement in the voting system has unfortunately been due to issues of accessibility to voting mechanisms. This lack of engagement in the voting system has for years affected the funding for disability services in higher education. Until last year, we had not seen an increase in additional funding for a period of 27 long years, which is longer than some of our CUNY students have been alive. This need encouraged us, the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities, CCSD, CUNY's representative organization for the more than 11,000 students with disabilities, to help ensure that our community was well informed on how to vote, especially with the new method of the ranked choice voting system and the importance of how it impacts their lives and that of their loved ones. Next slide, please. Addressing this particular need will require a consistent and strategic perspective, as we needed to face the fact that we were still in the middle of a global pandemic and would need a tailored approach. Our strategy involved two aspects. First, educating students on all things voting. And secondly, encouraging them to join us as we advocated for more funding for disability services in higher education. The first strategy took us right back to basics, education. We knew that the more informed CUNY students were, the more likely it would be for our initiative to be successful. We, the CCSD leadership, began by educating ourselves. As modeled by CUNY faculty in our classrooms, we felt it was important to be knowledgeable on the information we intended to distribute to our community. Only then could we encourage and lead others by example, because actions speak louder than words. We partnered with CUNY Votes and City Votes. Once ready, we spotlighted how digital options such as social media played an important part in communication during the pandemic, and used that knowledge to develop workshops and provide education on the newly implemented ranked choice voting. In addition, not only did we host nonpartisan vice presidential and presidential debate watch parties with distinguished Professor James Vaca, where we were joined by CUNY college deans and presidents so that students were informed on all the candidates, but we also hosted a New York Times journalist who educated our students on how to identify fake news. As we engaged with our community, we quickly realized that the education piece went beyond the things already mentioned. We found ourselves educating students on how they could register to become voters. We demoed assistive technology on how to vote. We put together videos on the importance of the disabled vote, as well as a bilingual video explaining what ranked choice voting was, and distributed that across numerous social media platforms. We also educated students on how to request and use absentee ballots. And as we engage with the community, we dedicated a portion of every CCSD event to informing attendees about voter education and registration. The plan was to help students become more educated about the process and their roles in the community as informed voters. Now that students had the knowledge and presence to voice their concerns by the power of their vote, we encouraged them to get out the vote, because it was important that they joined us. It was important that they connected and showed up to meet with elected officials by way of opportunities, such as giving testimony and attending rallies about our needs for additional funding for disability services in higher education. This year, we hosted our third annual rally with over 500 participants. We were able to secure student participation from across New York State, which included public, private, and independent colleges. We did so along with dozens of elected officials from across the New York State Legislature who support enhanced funding for disability services throughout the state. This is proof that CUNY students with disabilities and our allies have truly built a coalition. Next slide, please. Through these grassroots efforts, we were able to ensure the development of a more informed student body. Our students were now more knowledgeable on things like if they could vote, how they could vote, and just as importantly, why they should. Students and their families were now more informed on candidate platforms and were able to better connect how decisions their elected officials made affected their daily lives as members of the disability community. As a community, we embraced others, such as immigrant students and their families, even if they were not eligible to vote, because they too are partners in our community. Educating them essentially transcended to educating their families, extended family members, and friends. Ensuring that everyone understood the new ranked choice voting system and how to participate in the process was key. We secured more registered CUNY voters thanks to the efforts of CCSD hosting and co-hosting 30 plus events on voter registration and education with 851 participants during a pandemic. We continued to see the fruits of our labor when after 27 years, New York State agreed to provide enhanced funding for disability services and higher education throughout the state of New York. We were awarded $2 million for this effort. While CCSD and students across the state are grateful, we have continued to connect, to lobby, and rally in coalition to ensure that students with disabilities have proper funding for their much needed services and accommodations. Together, we learned the power of the vote. Now, I'd like to share a bilingual video that we released on social media in an effort to, again, better educate our community. Now, hello everyone. My name is Leonard Blades, and I am a proud co-alumni advisor for the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities.
Hola, mi gente. Mi nombre es Lennyn Jacob, secretaria de CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities.
And we want to remind you that ranked choice voting is now an option in New York City for primaries and special elections.
Queremos recordarles que votación por clasificación de opciones ahora es el método en la ciudad de Nueva York para las elecciones primarias y especiales.
You have up to 5 candidates to vote for in your order of preference.
Usted tiene hasta 5 candidatos para votar en orden de preferencia.
Follow us on Facebook as the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities and on Twitter and Instagram, CCSD_advocates. And remember, folks, there is nothing about us without us.
Mi gente presente.
Yes, Lennyn, you said it perfectly. Mi gente presente. My people are present. I love that. Now, it is my privilege to introduce our next speakers. We have Alex Elegudin and our colleagues from the Mayor's Office for People with Disabilities. I'm sorry, yes, MOPD. Take it away, Alex.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, thank you.
Yep. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Alex Elegudin. My pronouns are he, him, his. I'm a white male who is sitting in a power chair, although you can't see that. I'm wearing a, apologies, I'm a little bit sick this morning. I took some COVID tests, they'll not have come back, but we are all virtual, so you're safe. I'm wearing a beige sweatshirt and have a blurred background. So today I'm here to talk about accessible transportation and some of the victories we've had over the years, but specifically how CUNY and CCSD have been incredible community partners. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time about myself, though I will drop tidbits as they relate to CUNY as I kind of go through some of these things. I am the former senior advisor, accessibility chief at MTA New York City Transit, the first person to serve in that role. At the time, I reported to Andy Byford, who hired me, And as we all know, Andy Byford changed the way that the MTA looks at accessibility and prioritizes accessibility. And I'll talk a little bit about that as we get into our issues and further down. Also, I'm the former, can you go back for 1 second? Apologies. I'm also the former accessibility manager at the New York City Taxi and Limousine Commission, where I worked on the 50% Yellow Taxi Initiative, the Accessibility Wave Initiative for the Accessibility Initiative for Ubers and Waves. I'm gonna get a lot more into the details and how CUNY and CCSD came out and helped me, my team, the agency I work for, and our community and our disability community as a whole be successful on accessible transportation. I've lived my life as an advocate and a person with a disability, trying to improve quality of life for people with disabilities across the 5 major topics of quality of life, which is housing, education, healthcare, employment, transportation. Obviously, there are other issues like voting, government participation, I can go on and on, but through my nonprofit Willing Forward and through my work in government, and I always say our work as a community, you know, we've made a lot of strides in the last 2 years. Unfortunately, it takes a lot more than a few years to fix some of these things. So next slide, please. As I get into the issues surrounding transportation, we know them well. I will drop one other piece of CUNY shut up. I am a CUNY graduate myself. I graduated Brooklyn College. Oh boy, 2005, 2006, something like that. I went on to go to law school, went to Hofstra Law School, became an attorney until I became a quote unquote accessibility disability professional working for government. I worked in government pretty much exclusively from 2015 to, I don't know, some years later. But let's get into the issues. We all know New York City lacks adequate means of accessible transportation, right? Somebody lives in Queens, they gotta get to work in Manhattan. How do you do that? It's challenging. Some folks can drive, some folks can take the subway, some folks can take buses, some folks can take accessoride. There are options, but those options still have some ways to go. And I'm gonna talk about how we've tried to improve those options. I mean, in today's world, thankfully we have some remote options for work. But at the same time, often transportation can be a major barrier to employment, major barrier to education, and pretty much a major barrier to everywhere, right? We live in New York City. You often are not within 2 blocks of where you're going. Let's get, you know, getting a little bit more into the challenges. Only about 25% of the subway stations are accessible. I think today that's pushing towards 30 with progress we've made in the last 2 years. But since, you know, the original key station plan passed in the early 90s, since some of the ADA was passed, we've only gotten a quarter of the way there. We wanted that as a community to get much faster and to make it a much bigger prioritization. And we're gonna talk about some of how we did that, how we got there. We're not there yet. But I will say we are moving much faster than we ever have on this specific topic. Paratransit. A lot of folks use accessoride to get around. Accessoride became a thing in the 1990s because the subway station routes were not accessible. We've made some strides on accessoride. There's still room to go. And last but not least, and this doesn't identify all the transportation issues, but I just want to identify issues that, you know, some of the larger issues today in my 10 minutes to speak, is also taxis and rideshare. Both yellow taxis and Uber and Lyft have traditionally offered limited wheelchair accessible service, as well as having features and accessibility features for those who may be deaf or hard of hearing or low vision or blind. And when I generally use the word accessible, I do mean across, you know, the spectrum of disability. And the various categories. Next slide, please. So I'm gonna go a little bit faster because I know we're a little bit limited on time. We'll leave time for questions, but as I stated, we needed to get more subway stations accessible. Specifically, when I joined the MTA, there was a big push by CUNY and this NCCSD, hey, you have stations like City College, by, I think that's 137th. You've got 149th Street. Stations near certain CUNY in the Bronx, near certain CUNY campuses, that absolutely should be prioritized for accessibility. We have the largest population of students with disabilities, certainly in New York City. And students, as we made a push internally with Andy Byford, myself, working with elected officials, with the chairman, we worked internally, but we can't do it internally unless we get the disability community to come out and support. We had many organizations coming out telling us, hey, accessibility is a big deal. We started an active committee, which is an advisory committee for transportation. Leonard, others from CUNY participated, gave us guidance. Once we finally got the approval to do 50 stations, right? And 50 stations is a very kind of big deal, over 5 years, 50 station upgrades. Traditionally, we were only doing, the MTA was only doing 15, maybe 18, 19 stations over a five-year capital plan. After prioritization change, advocacy, we were doing three times as many, right? 18, moving to 50. We sped up that it might be three, that's three times as many. It made it realistic that the transportation, that the subway system would become fully accessible at some point. When we had our meeting saying, how do we select the next stations, right? You only have so many resources. We had CUNY students, we had other organizations coming out saying, hey, this station's important for us. I'm a student with a disability, I go here. All those things made it incredibly important, not only in us, not only in the MTA making more stations accessible, but in selecting things that matter to students with disabilities, to others in this city, and moving them faster. Improving accessoride and on-demand services. You know, we've had a lot of students, a lot of advocates, disability advocates, those who attend CUNY or formerly attended CUNY, come out to MTA board meetings and express that accessoride needs to be better. We have an on-demand option now. It is not available to everyone. I'm sure it's something, and I'm not at the MTA, but I'm sure it's something the MTA is looking to expand because we've had so much outreach. You know, and it's, what's interesting is how accessoride and our work together about taxis, right? I'm gonna talk about taxis for a bit. Do you remember the days when yellow taxis had no wheelchair accessible service, or the days when Uber and Lyft, you know, they had no wheelchair accessible vehicles on the road? During my time with the committee, with the TLC commission, with the mayor, with others, we wanted to pass the Uber and Lyft accessibility rule. Very difficult, lots of hearings. I have to give a huge shout out, because when we had those hearings, Uber would send tons of their drivers saying, no, we can't provide wheelchair accessible service. Oh, it's gonna make our drivers poor and broke. They can't feed their families. We had disability advocates. We had a huge showing from CCSD coming out saying, we demand this service. We demand to have wheelchair accessible service. Long story short, we were able to pass the strongest accessibility rule in the country as it relates to Uber and Lyft. And most places across the city today, if you need a wheelchair accessible vehicle, you can get it within less than 10 minutes. Now, that being said, it means a lot more than just being able to call an Uber and a Lyft. Why? Look at accessoride, how it's changed in the last few years. How many more times are you getting picked up by a yellow taxi? How many more times are you getting picked up by a green taxi? By doing the work that we did together as a community to get wheelchair accessible vehicles on the road, to get a better accessible service model from our taxi industry, we were able to reduce the blue and white vans, the amount of trips done on them, and get taxis in some form or another, whether it's yellow taxis, black cars, are doing 70% of most accessoride trips today. That's a major shift, major change that we all work together to accomplish. So I say all this to say, everything works together. You make transportation more accessible, employment goes up. You work on taxis, the MTA gets better. It is all pieces of the same puzzle. And we have to keep working to knock off piece by piece the barriers that exist towards full participation in society for people with disabilities. I'll do the next slide and I'll try to finish up quickly. I think my 10 minutes are running out. Again, we have a much greater prioritization of subway stations and MTA accessibility. Yes, the buses have been 100% accessible for a long time, but we know with new buses, there's more seats, it's a better service. So it's getting the movement started, but it's also about progressive improvements of accessibility at the MTA. Again, taxis was a huge victory. The rules that we passed in New York City have served as models in numerous cities across the country, Chicago, Philadelphia, San Francisco, where they look at New York as an example of how to provide accessible service. There's definitely more work to be done. And, you know, as we talk about the five major categories, education, employment, every time one of those categories moves forward and there's a piece of the barrier removed, and it makes it that much more possible and that much more opportunity for us to participate. It's a huge deal, you know? So I say all this to say, a lot of that comes from CUNY. I'm a CUNY grad. I've worked with CCSD many, many times. They're often one of the first groups that I call. Why? Because CCSD is, they're good, they're neutral, they're realistic, they're great advocates. You know, I worked in government. It's not that easy to call every organization because there's lawsuits, there's other things. But hey, lawsuits aren't the only way we get things done. We have to be friendly, we have to be partners. And for those of us that either work in government or in Albany or in the city, it takes a joint effort from the community and from us to push the needle forward. So with that, I bid you adieu and thank you all for your time and all your support over the years. And we have a lot more work to be done, but piece by piece, we're really making the puzzle move. I pass it off to my friends at MOPD to talk about some of their employment initiatives and how they've worked with CUNY and CCSD to move the needle a lot, very significantly, on a major topic, which is employment. Thank you all.
Hello, everyone. Can everybody see me? Hi, everyone. My name is Liliana Capterges, and I'm the Business Engagement Coordinator for the Mayor's Office for People with Disabilities Employment Program, NYC at Work. My pronouns are she, her, and ella, because I'm a Latina woman. I'm a light-skinned Latina woman, like I said. I have dark, curly hair, dark brown, but it looks black on the picture. I'm wearing rose gold glasses, and I'm in the office right now, also wearing a white blouse with small tiny sunflower prints and a navy blue blazer. So thank you for inviting us to this webinar today. And right now, as a representative of MOPD, my colleague and I, Eli Ramos, we're going to concentrate on the portion of employment. I know our community, and when I say our community, I'm also including myself because I am a person with a mobility issue. I'm a disabled person, and I'm also a CUNY graduate. I graduated from LaGuardia College, from CCNY, and in the future from Baruch. So if we can go to next slide, please. Okay, so like I said before, today we're gonna concentrate on the employment portion of the issues affecting our community. And so our office understands and identifies the following issues. The first issue being that people with disabilities are the largest and untapped talent pipeline, not only locally here in New York City, but also globally. And that is due to multiple reasons. We also have, as a community, people with disabilities tend to have much, much higher unemployment rates and jobless rates in general. And another important point that we have identified is that college graduates with disabilities are often either unemployed or underemployed. And there I want to include the role of internships and how internship comes to be in our future programs here at MOPD. And the next one has to do with the pandemic and the post-pandemic workforce. It has to do on how the pandemic changed opportunities for our community. For some of us, it's great that now we have other, like I said in my next point, remote or hybrid work options. But for some other members of our communities who lack the necessary training to deal or to even work with this type of technology, then it creates a kind of an issue as well. Can we go to the next slide, please? So as a government organization or as a government agency, as a mayoral office, we have a plan, and our objective is to address the jobless rate, of New Yorkers with disabilities. And like Alex was saying, continue moving that needle, but in this case, we'll be down and reducing that jobless rate. And our initiative is to create a business-driven, person-centered public-private workforce development program to help and assist New Yorkers with disabilities and get connected to meaningful unemployment opportunities. Another action that we have, another strategy that we are devising and we continue to work on it, is to increase city government hires through demystifying the 55A programs, either for city agencies or also for our job seekers. The next one is provide access to free, current and confidential finance and counseling for New Yorkers with disabilities and their families. Oftentimes, people with disabilities struggle with finances because we mostly have more expenses or tend to have more expenses due to perhaps the nature of a disability or what have you. And the final point is address lack of work experience and professional networks for college students and recent graduates. Oftentimes, when we have college students with disabilities graduating, they're missing that internship component. They're missing that experience that is so important for them to qualify for positions. And with that being said, I'm gonna pass it over to my colleague, Eli Ramos. Take it away, Eli.
Thank you, Lily. Seated 3 feet away from you. I'd high five you, but we're separated by plexiglass. But thank you nonetheless. All right, so my name is Eli Ramos. I am the Business Engagement Associate for NYC at Work, our employment initiative here at MOPD. I am a Latino male. My pronouns are he, him, his, y él, por supuesto. And I am wearing a blue plaid shirt, seated here in my cubicle, with black hair, dark brown eyes, olive skin, some mild scruff, facial hair, and I'm wearing a headset. And I am also glad to be here today. So with that said, I'm going to go into piggyback off of some of what Lily was saying and go into some of the actions that we've taken in response to some of those points that Lily was making before. So what did we do? We created NYC at Work. It's acting as a convener for businesses, city agencies, provider partners, state VR, colleges and universities, CUNY included, and unconnected job seekers. And like I said, CCSD is part of that. And as the song says, I tip my hat to you, but I haven't got a hat. Nonetheless, as Alex was saying, it does take a village to move some of these initiatives forward. So we thank you for being a part of that. So we held our first citywide 55A symposium in collaboration with DCAS, Citywide Administration Services, and the city agency's Equal Opportunity Offices. We also created Empowered NYC, which is free and confidential financial counseling for New Yorkers with disabilities. And we've also created our internship to career pathways, which Liliana actually spearheads. And we've been able to connect people to countless opportunities. Next slide, and we're gonna close this off. So what were the results? NYC at Work, we've been able to connect over 500 New Yorkers with disabilities to employment in all of the high growth sectors. And 100 of those were in New York City government through 55A. We also provide disability etiquette and awareness trainings, which I spearhead. We've done orientations, workshop career exploration events, targeted recruitment events, reaching over 6,000 participants. And that was even during a pandemic, right? And in 3 years, Empowered NYC has helped over 1,000 New Yorkers with disabilities and their families in reducing their debt by close to $500,000 and to allow them to save nearly $26,000 as well. That is so important. We've also been able to connect 45 students and recent grads to internships paid for either by the employer or with support from Access VR and New York State Commission for the Blind. As far as the next steps go, once again, I just want to tip my hat off to CCSD. We certainly value your partnership. And like Alex was saying, there is more work to be done. And you know, it's really incumbent on CCSD and other advocacy groups to get students with disabilities connected to these opportunities and engaging in that dialogue between faculty, between administrators, between the students themselves, so that we can get more people connected to opportunities, including internships while you're in school. That is so important in a real world application. With that said, I'm gonna yield my time over to the moderator once again, and thank you so much for having us. It's been a great pleasure.
Thank you, everyone. Do we have any questions for the speakers? And once again, if you have any questions, you can throw them into the chat. Okay, thank you everyone for attending our final session. And thank you to CCSD, MOPD, and UDL Squared for an amazing presentation. We are a little past three, so we do have to end the session soon. So thank you everyone for attending our final session for the 13th Annual CUNY Accessibility Conference. And thank you to our speakers today.
But would you like me to go now, Tanya?
Yes.
Oh, I agree. She's like, yes. Wonderful. All right. Thank you. Thank you so much to the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities, CCSD, our CUNY alum, Alex, and our friend at the Mayor's Office for People with Disabilities, MOPD, Eli and Liliana, also an alum, my friend and partner in all good things, Raymond Perez. Our amazing ASL interpreters, Alyssa and Phoebe, we were so amazed you were able to keep up. We really do appreciate it. Our conference committee, our colleagues in information technology, IT, our keynotes and presenters, and all our partners across the state and country for attending this conference throughout the week. You do amazing work supporting our disabled students, leaders, and colleagues. Nothing about us without us. Thank you all and have a great day.
All right, I'll be ending the session.
Thanks, Tanya. You're the best.
Take care, everyone.
Bye-bye.